One operations session. We have about a two-hour session for you guys this morning, and we have a great panel for you. So we're going to go ahead and get started with Jonas.
Good morning, everybody. This morning we're going to talk very specifically and learn from the experiences of some of our community members that have gone before us in terms of launching integrated behavioral health in a practice. And we have four practice managers joining us today to help us with this. And Carol O'Neill from Westwood Mansfield Pediatrics. Westwood Mansfield was one of the first practices in the program to hire behavioral health clinicians. They've been doing this for somewhere between 4 to 5 years. Lynn Doxer Cornell from Longwood, Kim Brewer from Northampton, and Kathleen Sullivan from Bridgewater are also going to participate in our discussion today. Between these four teams, they have hired 11 behavioral health providers across these four practices. So these are very experienced practice leaders who are going to be sharing some wisdom with you today. And without further ado, I'm just going to kick this over to Carol, who's going to start with a little bit with a presentation about the work that they did at Westwood Mansfield to launch integrated behavioral health. And then in turn, I'm going to ask Lynn and Kim and Kathleen to sort of comment and share some wisdom about their programs and then open it up for questions and discussion. So Carol, why don't you take it away?
So you should be able to share your screen. It's a green button.
Okay, we'll just go through the slides, Carol. Make it easy.
Just say just next say slide. Okay.
There we go. Well, good morning, everyone. So yeah, we started about 4 years ago. And so what we started to do before we decided that we needed a behavioral health integrated person, you know, we wanted to think about what it is we needed. And plus we noticed that we experienced, and I'm sure all of you were experiencing the same thing, gaps in the community referral process, a lot of trouble getting treatment in a timely fashion for all patients. And that was one of the main reasons, and I'm sure many of you are experiencing the same thing. Slide.
Carol, is there any way to adjust your microphone? We're just having a little trouble hearing.
Hold on just a second. I seem to have both the phone and the voice on the computer. Let's try this. Okay, is that better?
Yeah.
Are you using your telephone?
I have the telephone on, but the phone and I have the computer voice on, so I don't know how to shut that off.
Okay, no one can hear. She's a call.
I think she has the phone.
So Carol, can you just confirm, do you have your phone on or are you calling it through your computer right now?
Right now I'm in the computer because I don't know how to shut it off.
Okay. Is there any way you could use headphones and the computer?
Let me try, yes. Okay. Sorry guys. Let's see if this will work.
How's that? Is that better?
Wow.
Okay. Hold on just a second. All right.
That's great, Carol. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Okay. So, thank you. So, knowing your purpose. So, you know, we had to look at what our providers were needing, and we obviously found that there was a lot of inconsistent communication between behavioral health, outside behavioral health, and our PCPs. And, you know, we would send someone off to an outside therapist, and then, you know, there really wasn't a lot of coordination between the primary care and the behavioral health. Lots of questions that weren't answered. And we also found that our primary care providers were looking for more support managing behavioral health. And we seem to be getting more of an increase in those types of visits. And they really needed that help. So those were the reasons on the provider end that we decided it was a good time to look at bringing in a behavioral health specialist. Next slide. On the practice side, we noticed lots of high cost overruns for the specialists, the pharmacy. And again, you know, you're sending your patients out, you don't know what they're being, what types of medications are being ordered. You don't know where else they're being sent off to. And we also noticed that, you know, with high deductibles, you all are experiencing it. We're all experiencing higher patients are putting their hand in their pocket more often and the expenses are higher. We had to find another way to show value in, you know, why are you coming to our practice? You know, we're all pretty much the same, and we had to find a way to, you know, look differently and be more of more value. And we've actually had patients transfer to our practice so they could utilize our behavioral health program. So it's definitely makes the parent feel better paying more, higher co-pays and more expensive treatment. It does bring a lot more value to your practice. Next slide. So we decide we're going to do it. So what do we do? So back 4 years ago, and it's probably still an option today, do you hire someone or do you lease them? We chose to hire. It was a risk because we were an early adopter. But we felt that it was more important to have, you know, more control over the process and the performance of that clinician. We also felt that having that hired therapist in the office as part of our community was going to have a better sense of collegiality. They would have a more of an ownership in the practice and the kids. And we felt that the consistency of their service quality would be much higher. We didn't feel that we would have that opportunity with a leased option. Next slide. So, you know, what do you look for? Any one of these trained types of training they're going to be fine. It's really more about focusing on the individual experience and what is their interest in care coordination with your primary care physicians. That's an important piece to tease out when you're meeting with candidates, because I did find, you know, there were some who you could, you know, you really could feel it, that they were much more siloed and not really experienced in working in a team. So really don't hire someone that hasn't worked with a team in some form. Our first therapist was working in a school. So there was a lot of collaboration within his experience. So it's really important to know what you need. And you have to know what skill sets they have. And is it going to meet up with your patient's most common problems? So you really need to know what are the types of things, what are the diagnoses that you're sending out? So if you go to the next slide, it talks a little bit about that. So how do we, you know, we had to figure out, you know, what are we sending out mostly for behavioral health? So we monitored our outgoing referrals for about 2 to 3 months so that we could identify what kind of qualities and training do we need to find in our candidate. And then you hire to those needs so that you can keep those things in-house so you're not referring those types of diagnoses out. Next slide. So the other really big important thing is personality. So training is training is training. I think, you know, those three different types of training, they may be, you know, a little bit different in their trainings, but it's really more about this person's personality. They need to be flexible in their daily schedule. Will they be able to handle, you know, a knock on the door or, a meeting in the hallway, or can you come and meet this person? Also, really important in our model in the PPOC, it's really very goal-directed and consultative in nature. It's not, you know, you don't want someone who's not going to be able to, you know, work with a person and have a, you know, short goal-directed ways of dealing with it. And, you know, we don't have the space in our schedules for weekly visits. So can this person adapt to that type of model? And does this person seem to fit, know your own practices, social and clinical needs, know the population of your, you know, will they match with the population of your kids and parents and your makeup of the practice? Will they fit in well culturally and socially? So those are really important parts of what you should be looking for when you're hiring someone. Next slide. So you finally find somebody and you really need to think about the onboarding process. I'll tell you, the credentialing process is slow. Make sure you allow plenty of time when you're choosing your start date. And also, once you have the clinician on board, have a very clear plan on how you're going to work with this person and, you know, get them incorporated into your practice. The PPOC, of course, will establish supervision for the candidate. So that part is, kind of already in place for us. But really make sure that you have plenty of time, that you bring the candidate in to meet with your staff, not only your clinician staff, but your support staff, because they're very important in getting established as well. And make sure that you have very good training pieces in place. And bring them in. It's okay to bring them in a little early while, you know, if, let's say that credentialing is a little bit slow. If you can afford to bring them in a little sooner, it's really important to have them collaborate with the workflows that you have to put together, to make this the whole piece work. So, you know, it's a little bit of a expense in the beginning, but it is a really important and worthwhile expense to bring that person into how you're going to make appointments and creating policies and things of that nature. So it would be beneficial and best if you can do that. And also, you want to make sure that you're advertising the current patient base. This is not a system where you want to be bringing patients in from outside of your practice. This really works best because you won't have enough space, obviously. This is only for patients that are currently in your practice. And as I said, we did in the beginning experience some transfers in, and we do occasionally still get them because of this great service that we offer. But think about how you're going to advertise out to your patient base as well. Slide. So preparing the practice in terms of providing education, for what we did was we picked a few of our leading providers to take the behavioral health education. We did it on about a year in advance, and I'm sure a lot of you are doing that right now. And what they did was they would take that information. They created these great educational binders, and we assembled them and brought them back to the entire provider group. And we would present those at meetings. So we would start to have, you know, have very many, several consistent meetings. Basically, we did them on a monthly basis, and the providers that went to the training would bring it back and train the rest of the clinician staff. That seemed to work really well, and it was very organized. So you want to pick, if you have a large enough staff that you're going to pick a few, you know, pick ones that have some leadership quality that will be able to be organized enough to bring information back to the rest of the clinical staff. Next slide. And again, you know, we had to establish these clinical protocols. So this was something where you want your clinical staff to be together to do. We had one for following up for the SSRI medication. How are we going to handle crisis? And how are we going to handle the internal referral protocol? You know, we're used to the external protocol of referring. So now we're going to be having internal referrals from our clinical staff to our behavioral health staff. So those were some of the protocols we had to work on. Next slide. So with that, we had to start with staff meetings. Again, about a year prior to launch, we rolled it out to our staff. We explained what we were doing, explained the program, what the plan was, and, you know, started getting everybody on board and starting to think about it. And then about 3 months before launch, we started setting up departmental meetings to begin all the mapping out for workflow processes. And by now we had our candidate ready to go. So we did bring him on as well to help with some of this work. Next slide. So we created workflow processes. The most important thing was to really think about, you want to include all levels of your staff, because you want to start thinking about how your departments interrelate, the front desk to the back, billing, all of these things. You've got to bring them together for these certain exercises. So we used process mapping, and I think that we were taught by PPOC. I'm sure that they're still helping with those types of things. I wasn't familiar with them myself, but I did find them to be very, very helpful for these, you know, to really tease out the process. So we had one for the front desk. What's going to happen when it comes through? How do we make an appointment? What's the workflow for that? What's the triage workflow, the referral workflow? And we worked on these with smaller groups, and then would bring it to a larger group. We'd have dinner meetings and things like that. We'd bring it to those particular staff members. We'd refine the process. And so it was a bit of a process, but that's what worked for us. Next slide. So here's a picture of my whiteboard in my office. And I show these because I think it's important for you to understand that you don't need to be perfect. You just start. You just start by thinking through how things happen in your practice. And it can be as simple as and as messy as this looks. And it just starts to tease out. You got to go from A to B to C. What happens between B and C? What do we have to have in place for this? So this is how I started. And, you know, again, I wasn't familiar with process mapping. So I don't want to get all caught up in you know, doing it perfectly. I just knew the basics, and so I started this way. The next slide shows, again, you know, I wasn't ready. I didn't have time, and I wasn't ready to figure all this out on a, you know, on a program. So I knew what the process was supposed to look like. So I did it by hand, and it helped. This one was for the triage. You know, what do you do? Where does it come in first? What is it? What do you do if this happens? What do you do if that happens? And, you know, you have to have, this is why it's important to have the right staff helping you with this. Because they're the ones doing the work. So those are the people that need to be involved in this process. Eventually, we got better at it, and the next slide shows it, you know, how we finally figured out how to do everything, and we had everything in place. And this is our appointment protocol, and these were really important to the staff. It was so necessary for them to have, you know, if this, then that. And it's very focused on how our practice works, and so your practice will be different. So just have to, you know, do this exercise in order to get these things in place. And the next slide is just another one that shows the clinical process mapping. This one is for our SSRI. When a physician or a nurse practitioner orders an SSRI, we have a protocol in place to follow that patient, because it is a little different from medicine, you know, the medical side of our world. So, we had to make sure that we had these things in place to follow these types of appointments and diseases. Next slide. So, in order to do that, one of the things we did was we assigned a specific role for behavioral health care coordination. Not every practice will have that benefit. If you have one care coordinator and you have a smaller practice, you know, you may have to incorporate this into that person's job role. We chose, we asked our nursing staff who might be interested to do some of this work. And we began by taking that nurse out, you know, of the regular schedule of, you know, for smaller periods of time until it grew into what it is today, where it's a full-time job, because we have three behavioral therapists. But we do need someone on the support staff to take on this role to follow that SSRI management protocol. That preferably should be a nurse, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. We also created a high-risk registry for the kids that were admitted to hospitals and things of that nature, suicidality patients, things like that. The therapist will put them on a high-risk registry or one of the PCPs. And then we also needed something for missed appointment protocols, because we want to make sure that we're following these kids if they don't show up for their appointment. So for us, it was, it was easier just to focus on one person doing that job. It may not always be possible, but if you can, it does help, but you can always incorporate this as you grow and have a, you know, you're not as busy with behavioral health patients. It could be a dual role for a care coordinator. Most importantly, make sure that someone is responsible for those follow-ups. Next slide. Then we started to, as we got along, we realized we really needed to put a team together to make sure that all of these workflows and protocols are working. So we put the team we put together with care coordinator, behavioral health clinician, all of, whoever you have, your behavioral health clinicians, medical director, or lead PCP, and other key employees like a front desk supervisor or a front desk person, a billing staff person, because we really wanted to make sure that everything was working properly. So we would review on a monthly basis who's newly diagnosed on SSRI, so that we've got them on the radar. Are our screening tools working? Is the process working? Are we utilizing them in the proper way? And how are all our other workflows, our appointments and our billing, referrals, how's everything working? And in this type of setting, that's where we would hammer out things that needed tweaking or improvement or, you know, things of that nature. So it's really important to have that follow through on these protocols that have been put in place to make sure everything's working properly. Next one. And you have to think about your space plan. And again, you know, I've been doing this a long time. I know we will use every nook and cranny we can in our buildings. You've got to really be thoughtful about where you're going to put this behavioral therapist and prep it properly with insulation. You want it to be a pleasant, calming atmosphere. You want it to be comfortable. You have to think about noise management equipment for privacy. You need to order, and you know, just make sure you get comfortable furniture. And then there's going to be supplies, and your in-house therapist will help you with that, what types of books you need and games and things like that. So this is a really important piece. You can't just, you know, throw them in the basement or somewhere in a corner. Some, you know, you really need to think about all of these things, privacy, comfort, things of that nature. So that's an important piece you have to think about. Next slide. And then there's the billing and revenue cycle. You have to think about that. You know, some people want to outsource the billing. We chose not to do that. What we did was we found a group that was did only behavioral health billing, and you know, it was an outside agency, and we hired them to come in and train our internal billing staff. They came in, I think, once or twice to give us the, you know, the basics on behavioral health billing, and then I kept them on a retainer for 6 months. For questions, you know, on an ongoing basis. And I found that to be very valuable. And it's pretty straightforward, the billing, but it's a nuance that you need to learn and understand. So that was helpful for us. That's how we did that. And then for us, one staff member managed all of the incoming referrals and the authorizations. So that, again, worked very nicely. It's a lot easier have one person accountable for certain things. You keep better control that way. And this was a new process for us, taking internal authorizations and referrals. So that's how we handled it. And it's been very, very well received and working very well since. Next slide. So some of the lessons that we learned. So, you know, it's not a money maker. You know, hopefully you're not going to lose money. We don't lose money. But this isn't something where you're going to make a lot of money. But there is a really intangible value to this whole program. You're definitely going to have happier parents and patients. They're going to be getting better, timely, quality care. It's going to be convenient. It's in their pediatrician's office. We've heard feedback from parents and some of the older kids. It's less of a stigma for them to come to their primary care doctor. You know, they're not going to a therapist's office. So it's more comfortable for the kids, very convenient. The provider's ability to manage patients more closely has been a game changer, honestly. And the providers themselves, the primary care providers, the pediatricians and the NPs, they feel so much better supported. It's much less stressful in their daily job. They do still get those crisis calls. Sometimes they have time in their schedule to take them on, but if they don't, there's always a behavioral therapist that can take it, and it certainly helps with all of that crisis intervention and time. It's definitely freeing up the provider's time to see more patients so that, you know, these visits can, you know, take 30, 40, 50, 45, 50 minutes, plus all the care coordination that goes along with it. It really does have a lot of intrinsic value. And it does, you know, in the beginning, for sure, increased our new patient transfers. We do still see them occasionally. It's not as heavy as it was in the beginning, but because one of the requirements is that it has to be a patient in your practice, you will see an increase in patient transfers to some degree. Next slide. Hello?
It's on the next slide.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay, and then lessons learned on appointment management. This is really important. I learned this very quickly. Don't allow more than 3 appointments on the books at any one time. You'll have parents, and you know them, we all have them, they'll want to stop booking, you know, out for a year. You know, you really don't want to do that. There isn't enough space in the schedule for it. And, you know, you will have no-shows and things like that. So you should never allow more than three on the book at one time. Have a very clear policy for missed appointments. Have it ready to go on day one so that the therapist can go over that and, you know, with them in their first visit. Schedule your new evaluations in the morning. Parents will have no problem taking their kid out for, you know, the initial evaluation. You know, they're anxious, they want to get in, they'll take a morning appointment. Save those follow-up appointments for the afternoon. So the way we structured it is we have all of our evals in the morning and in the afternoon are for follow-ups. And that seems to be a lot better for that type of thing. And then leave available space in the schedule for your crisis events, your spontaneous warm handoffs, all their collateral work that they have to do. You know, they're calling schools and, you know, other places that your therapist. So make sure you have some space in there for that. And the crisis events, for sure, we assign those times. We have more than one therapist, but if you have one, have some space in there for that as well. Next slide. All right, that is it for me. Let's go to the next thing. Okay.
Carol, thank you. You know, I just want to just pick on a couple of things that you said as especially important. I mean, you talk a lot about the nexus of, you know, care coordination and behavioral health provider. And, you know, that's really a critical linkage and, you know, the collaborative work that those two people do in the practice is critical. You know, I think you're talking about, you know, this monthly team meetings and, you know, this is not only important during the preparation phase, but, you know, it's important to sort of monitor what's taking shape and, you know, a valuable thing to have in place to improve what you're doing over time.
Yes.
And, you know, this idea that, you know, the financial aspect of it, I mean, you want to, like you said, I mean, nobody's getting rich doing this. And, you know, the math is, you know, you want to generate more revenue than your, you know, cost to your providers. And it's difficult. We had a conversation about this just yesterday about how difficult it is to quantify, you know, the cost savings of, you know, freeing up physicians, you know,
right,
and having, yes, them being more productive. But, you know, I hear this from everybody. I mean, so, you know, people are, you know, aware of this value that this adds, and, you know, it's hard to quantify, but I think really important part of the calculus.
Absolutely.
So I'm going to just call on Lynn to chime in and, you know, reflect on what you've heard, share some of your wisdom and experience, Lynn, about the launch of Integrated Behavioral Health at Longwood.
Oh, but we always kind of.
Hi, Lynn. You were muted. Sorry. Could you sort of?
Oh, sure. Yeah. We're similar to what Carol went over, although we did have someone here for many, many years before all this integration happened. But we didn't. It was kind of a different structure than it is now. But our patients were familiar with behavioral health. But we did ultimately do a similar, you know, the big integration. We hired. We at one point had two full-time behavioral health people. We then went to 1.5 and now we're back up to 2. But a lot of it for us was space. And then, so we weren't really able to see patients consistently until we renovated the office 5 years ago. So space was a big deal. And like Carol said, you know, we had to get stuff to mute the room and make it look nice and get games and stuff. One thing we have learned from our experience is that our room is really not very good. A lot of patients comment on how it's like white walls and it's not really a very great space for seeing patients. So we're working on that as well right now with a different kind of renovation. But I think you should take that into account. Probably we didn't appreciate that so much until kind of after the fact. But similar, we've done the warm handoffs. The physicians are really invested in this. We do meet every 2 months as well. We have physician leaders in behavioral health. They report out every partners meeting or every other partners meeting on what's going on. So it's a really important part of the practice. We are also not losing money, so that's good, but it's not a money maker, as Carol mm-hmm. said. Mm-hmm. But we are definitely meeting the needs of our patients. We've just hired a female clinician, so that's really helping with the young women of our practice who we probably weren't addressing as well. We used to have two male social workers, so we're really excited about that. We've already seen like a positive response just to her being here. But it's been really great. The doctors are very invested in it. We often see them in the hallways talking. They always bring in the social worker just to do that initial introduction to kind of take away the sting of, oh, you're going to see this person, and now at least you know who it is. So it's really been almost seamless. It seems like it's been here forever kind of thing. And just really important, I think, to the overall, you know, scope of what the practice offers. Similar to Carol, we have the initial consultation in the morning. They're more apt to do that. And then we save these others for the afternoon. Those are the hot ticket appointments that go very quickly. We don't book more than three out either. There are some patients who want to book forever, but we don't allow that. And it's also basically short-term therapy. So we don't want to encourage, hey, book for a year, because we don't, you know, really do that. So pretty similar to what she's saying. Everyone's well-versed in what to do and how to book it. And we also offer classes. Our social worker, one of them, does like a three-year-old class, or, you know, so at night, a group of like six families will come in and he'll do a presentation and answer some questions. So we're really trying to kind of diversify and expand what we're offering for behavioral health. So that's helped bring in some referrals as well, but we're really busy with behavioral health. We're not struggling to get people to come in for it.
Thanks, Lynn. Mm-hmm. Kim, do you want to share a little perspective with us, comment on what you've heard, and share some of the unique wisdom you've learned out there in Northampton?
Sure. Can you hear me okay?
We can hear you great.
Okay. Sort of in a random order, as far as the more of the recruiting side of things, we had the best luck on Indeed, which is the website we found most of our therapists on. I know out here in Western Mass in the Pioneer Valley, there's a listserv for social workers, and that's how we got our first group. So we put out an ad on, a notice on this listserv, and we got five resumes in 2 weeks. So if there's some sort of listserv in your area, that worked out well. I would be prepared to answer most of the candidates want to know salary expectations. They were hesitant to say how much they wanted, but they always wanted to know what our range was. So I would suggest that you be prepared to answer that question in the first interview. We just hired our third in 2 years. We've been doing this 2 years. We just hired our third, and we're already talking about interviewing for a fourth. And we're doing that based on wait time to next appointment and evals. So when we start running 4 to 6 weeks out to get you in for an eval, we're just starting to realize that, you know, we may need to do some more. Set schedule expectations early on, probably in the interviewing process, kind of like Carol said. We ask that the people stay until 6 or 7, 2 days a week. We happen to do a 4-day work week. One of the days is sort of catch-up admin time, clinical supervision, and the 4 days are just solid patients and warm handoff time. You just have to be careful as you expand about salaries, because, you know, if you start mixing in LICSWs with LMHCs, they can be paid different rates, and so you just have to keep that in mind. And definitely use the PPOC's, Boston Children's HR department to get you the salary range. But for those that are on the call from Western Mass, just remember that they are a little lower in Western Mass. But they were fairly in line with what we've been getting from the PPOC. As far as office space goes, we moved them since they started, and now they have a sub-waiting area, which worked out fabulously. So it happens to be three rooms right near each other. Two are behavioral health offices, and one is like a sub-waiting room. And it gets the people out of the regular waiting room, and our therapists have found that when they're calling parents in and out of the room, you know, they start with them, and then they ask them to go back, or they may ask the child to leave the room for a minute. That really works well, that they're right there by the rooms and not way back out in the waiting room. Make sure you review your resumes very well. We had a really bad experience with someone. Look for breaks in licensure. Look for, you know, sort of blocks of time where they didn't do anything. The other big thing I suggest is to clarify early on, are they staying in private practice or not? Our first behavioral health provider decided to stay in private practice, and that's very, very important for contracting, and the PPOC needs to be aware of that if they're going to keep their own private number to bill under, but they're also going to bill under the PPOC contracts. That's caused some issues for us. The other thing I point out as far as money goes, again, we make some money on it. We're not losing money on it. I do want to point out that there's significant payment delays with behavioral health as it compares to commercial insurance for medical. So for example, I look at, for my practice, I look at how much of my AR is under 60 days old. We average 93% for all our insurances, and we average 50% for behavioral health. So there's much more significant delays in getting paid on these. I'm hopeful that this is going to get better now that the ACO doesn't have a carve-out and we're not going through MBHP for our mass health patients as much anymore. But I haven't broken that out on the AR because it's all lumped in Tufts Public ACO. But that would be interesting to know. I probably can get to it. So that's my spiel.
Thanks, Kim. You know, I just want to comment, you know, you talked about being blessed with, you guys are blessed with space there, and you've been able to have a kind of designated behavioral health area, but many practices don't have that. And there's kind of a slippery slope you head down. If you have too much of a separate space, it begins not to feel as integrated. And I think many of our clinicians are very comfortable working right in the middle of the mix and sort of living and breathing and functioning every day, you know, in the clinical, you know, in the middle of the clinical office, not over in some sort of separate space. So it's a, it's one of these balancing act kind of things. And you're lucky to be blessed with lots of space.
Well, we bought a condo and we moved everybody out to make the space. Yeah. So that's how we did it. We bought a condo and I moved out all my appointments people, my triage people, my billing people, and that's how we got the space. They took my old office, actually. Oh. So, you know, we just have to think through what you want to do.
Yep. Kathleen, we're going to kick it over to you to kind of reflect on what you've heard and share the wisdom you've gained over the years at Bridgewater.
Well, I feel like a baby compared to these two ladies, so thanks for all that you guys have done. I'm just relatively, I've only been in this job for 2 years and never dealt with behavioral health, so it was a real learning curve for me. But I agree, there's a lot of just, if too many people are in the soup for me, like if I was starting out, I would definitely want just one person being the coordinator of all of the appointments, all the schedules. I found like it was just really confusing for staff, especially with, you know, building the behavioral health insurances and the different carve-outs to have the front desk doing that. And then when Epic came in, you know, there were those challenges with making sure that was okay. So I'm just looking at changing templates now because Deborah, I don't know if you know, but Deborah, our behavioral health coordinator, is retiring. So we have the opportunity for some new brains and new blood to come in with great ideas. So I'm hoping to kind of take a lot of what you guys said and kind of build a template to have the initials only in the morning. I mean, sometimes we're so busy. We have three consultants now. We're so busy. But then there'll be hours where our, like the other night I walked out and we have someone there till 7. We try and have someone available from 3 o'clock to 7 o'clock 4 nights a week, whether it's one or two or both. When we're there, we have three consultants, but sometimes they'll be just waiting for people and, or not have an appointment. So I want to take what you guys said and look at that. And we're also looking at maybe doing more 30-minute visits where I've been examining that too, so we can see more of our patients. And I think the lucky thing that we have, we're looking at is, you know, if you're trying to keep your costs down, when we're talking about the, you know, how much we're making in this department, which isn't a lot of money, but if you think about the anxiety appointments that would be going to the ER if they didn't have behavioral health in our practice, which is the highest cost, those ER appointments, I think it's, I don't think you can measure what that brings to a practice. So I just think there's a lot more that we need to do in our practice, and you guys really helped me, listening to you, think about what we can do in those changes. And it's a work in progress.
Well, that's important. Thanks, Kathleen. I mean, that idea that it's a work in progress, and I think, you know, each of you in some way has sort of reflected that, that it, you know, this is not something you just wind up and let it go. You know, you probably heard me say this before. I mean, it really takes a ongoing attention and a, you know, care and maintenance plan to sort of keep it running and keep it growing and improving. We're going to open up for questions. I have a question to start, and I just want to ask, you know, I'll circle back to Carol and start with her. I guess I'm curious, what did you expect was going to be difficult that ended up being sort of much easier than you expected in this whole process?
I think the billing for sure. I was very intimidated by that. So, you know, I was pleasantly surprised. I'm curious with Kim made a good point. I don't separate out my behavioral health AR, so I don't know what that looks like. So that's really interesting, Kim. So I'll have to do that. But in terms of, you know, just getting that piece organized and working seamlessly, I was surprised at that. What's a good question? I mean, that comes to mind mostly, but
okay.
Yeah, I don't know.
Lynn, how about you? What was something you were expecting to be pretty difficult that ended up being easier than you thought it would?
I guess maybe the marketing, the billing for sure, but that goes without saying, I guess, because that always intimidates us. But I think just making sure we could get the word out and fill the slots and, you know, we did a P&L and were we going to meet the, you know, what we thought in the time that we thought. And in the end, once we said we were doing it, we had, you know, good business flow. So that ended up being better than I thought, just better than expected. I think sometimes we've had a problem with people wanting to talk to the social worker on the phone for, you know, one quick question that ended up being a long time that we should bill for, and trying to navigate through telling patients that we can't really spend all this time with them on the phone and they should come in and make an appointment. So that was something that we had to adjust to as well.
Thanks. Kim, how about you? Did you expect to be difficult that's been easier?
I would agree with Carol. I would actually say the billing and referrals. We were very, very nervous about that. Our biller would never did behavioral health billing before. So we had to learn from scratch and we were very nervous, but it wasn't as big of a deal as we thought, especially with the referrals in Epic. You can link them to the appointments. So it auto decrements the referrals. If you put in 6 for like a Blue Cross Blue Shield, I'm making that up. You know, you can link the appointments in Epic and it auto decrements. For us, the thing I did not expect that happened is all of a sudden our providers want our care coordinators and our therapists to find Susie a therapist at 3 p.m. who speaks Spanish in such and such an hour. You know, there's this black hole of all of a sudden the providers feel this need to find every child a therapist. And it was like, what happened before we had these people? So we've been working a lot on that, because we've basically, you know, 2 years in, we've already used up all of our favors to get into outside services. Yeah. So, but we did a big community outreach where we hosted an open house with all the therapists. Again, we used that Pioneer Valley social worker listserv, and we called all the area therapists and agencies into our office one night and had some dinner and stuff, and just explained our program, what we were looking for them, what could we do for them with our patients, just to explain we're not here to steal your business, we're all here to just help the kids. So.
Okay. Kathy, is there anything you want to add
Yeah, we actually did the same thing as Kim. We've had a lot of community events. We've had like three or four where we've had probably 20 people, and we just all talked about services around the area and what we did for outside services, because obviously we need outside services sometimes.
Yeah.
And that was really helpful. The billing I thought was going to be much worse also. I thought it was awesome. And I think just the little workflows that we can kind of get caught up that we weren't pre-thinking, like once we link that referral, if there's a no-show, you have to just make sure someone's unassigning it so that the countdown on the referral stays correct and those types of things, and learning about, you know, the new count every year in the ACO starting, you know, January 1st, fresh 12 visits, and, you know, just little things like that that you have to kind of keep mindful of. We put them on a spreadsheet. And just keep them on our Google Drive just as a quick reminder so everyone has it. We share with the behavioral health, you know, people who book the appointment.
Thanks, Kathy. You know, Carol made reference to hiring a consultant to help train their billing staff and retain that for a while. And, you know, each of these practices joined the program at a time where they were using a vendor for that service. We're now providing that service centrally through the PPOC. I know a few people have had the benefit of that already, and I think that's going to be a real good thing to have that provided centrally for everybody.
Yes.
So we're going to open it up for questions. People can unmute themselves and speak or type in a question if they have it. Please take advantage of this enormous wealth of expertise and ask your questions. No questions, huh?
So we do have a question. Anyone open to speak to it? How would a smaller practice adapt to some of your workflows, do you think?
Someone at a shooting range or something? I guess I would ask, understand the question. What do you think we said? Sounds like it applies more to a big practice than a small practice.
I would think that in a larger practice, it's staffing. You have a lot of role specialization. I think in smaller practices, you have a larger number of people that wear multiple hats. And so how do you make those accommodations, you know? When you have a staff, small staff, people doing a lot of different things.
Feeling are already busy.
Yeah, and maybe, you know, maybe the integration managers, you know, these are all folks living in large practices. So you guys, you know, why don't you guys, Ellen, Jessica, Maria?
I mean, one thing that I see is that when we come in to support the practice with the integration piece is that, defining who does what, because a lot of practices have established kind of a homeostasis and a rhythm. And with BH, there are new tasks, which aren't onerous, but it is one more thing. Mm-hmm. And all of you have said, it's so important to have a coordination or someone kind of owning it. And that can be a challenge in a smaller practice.
Right. We do have another question. Are most appointments 30 minutes or do you have longer appointments? And I would answer that by saying there's a balance. And I'm going to let Carol, Lynn, Kim, and Kathleen sort of jump in and describe more about that balance.
Can you hear me? I was locked out for a second.
Yep.
This is Carol. Okay. We do have a combination. Most of them are 30 minutes, but we block 45. And that seems to, you know, work well because it gives the therapist, you know, a little bit of leeway. Sometimes they go longer, sometimes they go shorter. And it also gives them a little time for charting and calls and things like that in between. So we block 45-minute increments, but some, you know, then they will bill accordingly, whether they did a 30-minute, a 40, you know, 45, whatever. But that's how we definitely block 45.
So
how many?
So a related question is, how many patients do does your behavioral health clinician see in a day?
In a day, average for us is, well, we book 8. But with no shows and things like that, the average is probably 6.
Okay. How about day. The rest of you, the practice managers who are there, just curious across.
Sorry, this is Kim. We book probably about 8 or 9. We probably go into the day with 8 templated. And then aside from the warm handoffs, we have a designated urgent appointment only section. So we do not block off. We changed our templates a lot. We used to do 45-minute sessions with a 15-minute break, and we just weren't seeing enough patients. And so we do a combination of 30 and 45-minute visits. We made that change. We had Ellen, and she was huge in helping us figure out and working with the therapist as far as what kind of patients should you put in a 30-minute slot versus a 45. So if you're seeing someone a couple of times, to bridge them to an outside provider, maybe you do a 30-minute so you're not setting up the expectation of a long-term relationship. You know, similar no-shows, Carol mentioned that. I've heard others in the PPOC say that if someone no-shows an after-school appointment, they won't book them another after-school appointment for 2 more times until they can show up to their other appointments. There is a decent chunk of no-shows, so that's why I've sort of over-templated knowing they won't see that.
We try and keep our appointments to between 24 and, you know, max, if we have to, 30 a week for our providers.
I mean, one comment when people are talking about the no-shows, I think that that's an important role for us as integration managers. This disembodied voice is Ellen Goodman, and my colleagues Maria Araujo and Jessica Barton are also integration managers, and we'll work with you looking at your no-show rate and thinking about, to get X, how many do you need to book? So I think work in progress is the important concept here.
Mm. And we do have another question. You mentioned care coordinator. Is MHCC involved or is this someone else? I can speak for Lynn. I was the former MHCC at Longwood, and I did work closely with the behavioral health provider. What we did was really collaborate, and I would help with the external factors. So if the patient had anxiety, then Jay or Tim would work with them on that, and I would work on the contributing factors like homelessness or transportation to really give Jay and Tim the time to work directly with the patient.
And I can say that in the practices I work with, when there is not a designated medical home care coordinator, and or when the person who is the care coordinator is not tasked with being involved with behavioral health care coordination, it puts a lot of additional time responsibilities away to do care coordination on the, you know, that's put on the behavioral health provider, and that takes time away from when they can be seeing patients and families.
And part of that is tracking and high risk and the missed appointments. Oh.
Mm-hmm.
And to circle back to the, you know, the amount of time that clinicians are spending with patients, I mean, this is something that people have had to adjust along the way to help manage volume. I mean, as volume increases, you can't be working, you know, as often in these longer increments of time. And there's some necessity to, you know, thinking about, you know, learning how to work in these shorter increments of time, 30-minute increments of time, 20-minute increments of time. And, you know, across the an episode of care, not every, you know, intervention needs to be the same duration. So if you're at, you know, if you're beginning an intervention with a patient, you may need a little bit more time, but as you move into sort of a follow-up or maintenance phase, much briefer check-ins may be most appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions from participants? Feel free to unmute yourself and speak or type it in.
It's Kathy. I'd like to ask a question just about workflow. So we've had a number of people coming in seeing, you know, saying that they're thinking about hurting themselves in the office with their clinician. And so we're lucky enough to have our behavioral health specialist there. And so if we're sending them to the ER and trying to decide on that, we're lucky enough to call someone in. I'm just wondering if anyone has a specific workflow or documentation process that they have so that every provider in the office deals with that situation, because we're hearing it so much more the same exact way, because consistency is really important in delivering care. So, you know, one of our docs might just say, just go to the ER immediately. But if we have a clinician here who could come, just risk management wise, it feels better to know that we've already involved our BH department in that before they leave, so that they can, you know, first of all, we have someone looking out for the follow-up. We're booking them in with us for their next appointment, you know, making sure they got to the ER, making sure that they have a follow-up appointment with us all almost before they leave. Does anybody have a workflow for that suicidality office visit?
This is Carol. I don't know if we have it honestly written down. So you bring up a really good point. What we do have is with every day there is a crisis, and it's outside of their templates, outside of the behavioral health template. There's a crisis opening. But if the crisis comes in and it's past that opening, our triage does know to interrupt and, you know, talk, you know, get someone to talk to that child. But and then we'd have care coordination to follow through. But I don't know if we have it actually written down. I'd have to go back and look at that. If we do, I'm happy to send it to you. But I honestly don't know if we have it written down.
Yeah, I'm working on that, because I just think, yeah. You know, one provider does one thing, another provider does another thing, and say, you right. know, BH wasn't called in on that, and our care coordinator for BH wasn't aware of it, then it may fall through the cracks if she's off on Friday, and this happened Friday, and we're not looking at, you know, someone doesn't send her the ED report. So it just seems so much better for us that if we, you know, we get a social worker to go in there, they discuss, they do a quick evaluation and note, because it, you know, if they're noting it and we know what the follow-up is, and they happen to, and most of them do know that person because they're already in our seeing a social worker here, then, you know, it just seems risk management wise really smart to have a process for every single person to do the same exact way.
So it's a great question. And I think it's something that, you know, that every practice should think about. And it's certainly a discussion I think you should plan to have with your integration manager as you prepare to, you know, begin delivering behavioral health services. So I'm going to take one last question here before we move on to the next segment of the program. And the question is, if a behavioral health clinician is working until 7 p.m., are you having an MD stay until all behavioral health appointments are completed?
This is Carol. We do. We're open every night till 9. So yes.
And this is Kim. We're open every night till 8. So yes.
All right.
For those practices that aren't open late or typically, there's often an agreement that one night, if the BH clinician goes until 7. Usually there's someone doing paperwork or EPIC, as we call it now, documentation, and that there's an agreement that person will be there, that it won't kind of mess, because it's important to have someone else
And it's also important to have front desk staff available, because you really ideally want the same check-in and check-out processes for any patient, regardless of the time of day they're seen. So hypothetically, if nobody's there, who's gonna schedule the appointment? So if nobody's there, who's gonna take the copay, et cetera?
Yeah. All right, with that explained, we're gonna move on to the next segment of our program. I wanna thank our participants here, Carol, Lynn, Kim, and Kathy. Thank you so much for sharing your perspectives and accumulated wisdom.
Welcome.
All right. We're gonna move on. And we're gonna get into a more granular discussion about the importance of language. I mean, this is something you've probably heard me and others talk about before. We've all said this in different ways. The words are really important. And the words matter depending on who you're talking to. And it's important because the words have specific meanings and mean different things to different people. And I'm going to focus real briefly on a couple of aspects of internal communication. And then our team of integration managers are going to go into a lot more depth and detail around communication, and I think talk about both sides of this. But let's talk about internal, some critical parts of the internal communication. And I think most of you have already begun to engage your full team around these ideas. And from our perspective, I think there are these four sort of key points to emphasize with every part of your staff. And if you haven't engaged every part of your staff in these ideas, please do. I think it's important to make it clear that this is a choice we're making. And we're making this choice so that the provision of behavioral health care, this aspect of our patients' lives, this is going to become a central part of what we do. And we're going to improve our ability to care for our patients in this very holistic way. And I think most important is really, you know, as other people have emphasized here, this team idea that we're really in this together. To follow up a tiny bit on each of these points a little more, we've chosen to make this a central component of the care that we're delivering. I think it's important to engage providers and staff in understanding this and in shaping the ideas and sort of what this looks like in a practice. To do that, it's really important to explain why this is important. And I think it's really helpful. I'm really helpful to provide examples over time to your staff and provider team about, you know, the impact that this is having, how families are being helped and through this process. Behavioral health providers are, a core member of the team. So I think one of the things that helps deliver this message across the practice is to make sure that these providers are included in provider meetings, other sorts of important team meetings in the same way you would include your medical providers, and certainly include your behavioral health providers on your website, your signage, other sorts of, externally facing sort of material that illustrates who your team is. This requires change. Integrating behavioral health requires change. It represents a change in how we're going to approach and deliver care. And we all know that change is hard. Not everybody deals with change in the same way. And again, I think the important thing here is to focus on why you're all doing this and what the long-term benefits are, both for the patients that you're caring for and yourselves as a team. Finally, again, back to this idea, and pardon me if it feels like I'm a broken record here, but really this idea of we're all in this together. We need everyone's effort and ideas. Every practice picks sort of a starting point. Here's what we think is going to work. We develop these workflows and processes. And, you know, you pick the best starting point that you can and you go from there. And I can't tell you, you know, nobody's gotten it right, exactly right the first time. So it's always a process of continuous work and improvement, learning together, working together to accomplish this integrated type of service delivery. Sometimes the process can feel like this, but I don't want you to worry. You know, caring for people with caring for people's emotional health and taking care of these sorts of issues is never easy, but the process of organizing and changing the way that we practice so that behavioral health is kind of an integral part of the core of what we're doing, that does get easier with time. You know, sort of managing the content, I honestly say is never easy, but the way that we're going to do this does get easier. And with those few things said, I'm going to pass it over to our team of integration managers who are going to walk us through some of this language and communication stuff in more detail.
Good morning, everybody. Ellen Goodman here. And I'm going to take a quick moment to just introduce the integration management team. There's Jessica Barton and Maria Arojo. And Maria's in the western part of the state, so many of you out in that area already are acquainted with Maria. And without further delay, so I'm going to hopefully not be very redundant. I think there's a lot of consistent themes that you're going to hear today. And I'm going to try to focus more on the how as opposed to the what, the process of your journey as opposed to, we've talked a lot about the what. So the first thing is, you know, how are you going to prepare for your journey? You're going to set the purpose of your journey. And I think this is something that other people have mentioned today quite articulately. And it's the whole notion of, you know, your visions. Carol mentioned and when she started, set the purpose. Designate a pilot and a co-pilot. We've been talking a lot today about leadership and the need for good, strong leadership and ownership of different aspects of the program. Prepare your crew. Be inclusive. Bring people into conversations. Expect bumps on the road and construction areas ahead. It's a work in progress, and you really need to, everybody needs to have that spirit. It's not about succeeding and failing. It's about learning as you go and adapting as you need to. Take breaks to stay awake and revise your roadmap as you go. So the next part I want to say a little bit about is how you develop a consistent vision. Starting a new program really does mean a change throughout your whole practice system, and there will be an initial adjustment for everybody. And as we've learned through experience, communication is really an important theme to pay attention to. And it starts with you, your behavioral health team, and your practice, and how you communicate with each other about your behavioral health initiative. Every practice starts this with an idea of what it is they want. And many members of your practice have an idea about how your new behavioral health program might impact their workflow or their your practice as a whole. You will really want to create an opportunity to flesh these things out and to share your vision and to the extent possible, co-create a vision with your practice. So how do you get there? You really, you know, our recommendation is to have a practice-wide meeting that is facilitated by your core, your physician champion and your core behavioral health team and your integration manager, ideally. We can be there to answer questions that you may not yet know have answers to. So it's really about getting, flushing out what people's hopes and expectations are. And then you also want to create a space to inquire about their concerns. It's been enormously helpful when we've had the opportunity to meet with the whole practice and let people openly address their concerns. Much better to have them in the open where you can talk about them than have it be an underground concern and conversation that festers. Try to address the concerns raised while also being very reassuring. And again, you've got the ongoing support of your integration managers. You also have your colleagues out there in the PPOC who already have their behavioral program up and running, their resources for you. And this whole transformation will take time initially and more time initially, but soon you'll have your systems in place. So it's a work in progress, and let's all be patient. And I think that's the spirit that we really want to encourage you to embody with this. And then it's really important for you to remember that nobody has to go this alone, that you're there, you have your team, and you have our team here supporting you. Learning a new language. We've been talking a lot about language, so I'm going to go back to this for a minute. We have tried to sort of embody some of what traditional language might be and where we're moving in our language. But as Jonas said earlier, language is really important. And I think attention to using language that reflects the new model is going to help you and your team and your patients all begin to understand and embody the new model. So using the new language really can be significant. It can really prevent incorrect assumptions about the services you're offering. So these are our suggestions. We're moving away from co-location, we're doing integration, we're not referring because you refer to somebody on the outside. We're including the behavioral health provider in the care, having a warm handoff. We really shy away from using the word therapist because for many people that means I'm going to see you once a week for 50 minutes, you know, every week for a year or more. We talk more about provider, clinician, colleague. It's not therapy, you know, it's more meetings. We don't do long-term or short-term work in these settings. It's really more solution-focused, skill-based work with more brief episodic meetings. Rather than intakes, we're doing consultations. And we don't really terminate because the patients that we see continue to be patients of the practice. And because we're doing episodic care, we're ending for now. So thinking about developing your message, Jonas was speaking to the internal message, which we think about as your vision and your goal. Why has your practice chosen to have a behavioral health program, and what is your program going to be like? Moving from your internal message, you're thinking more about your external message. What will you say, and how are you going to develop an internal message that's consistent upon the consistent across the practice? So your external message might include the why of your choice to have the behavioral health program, but it will also include things like how you describe your services, what you call your behavioral health provider, and how to frame the initial consultation. Always including your behavioral health provider as you construct this message. You know, this will be a work in progress. I'm going to take a moment to go through the components on this page in more detail. So how to describe the services offered? What services you're going to be offering, you know, would include things like consultation, we're doing diagnostic assessments or assessments, parent guidance, follow-up sessions, excuse me. And which services will be offered and or which types of concerns are going to be addressed in your practice are something you also want to be thinking about, and that will be determined in collaboration with your behavioral health provider and your medical team. In thinking about the things about this, you know, describing the services that you offer, I also, you know, think it takes practice and it can be uncomfortable and no one like, in my field, people don't mind role plays so much, but my experience with the greater world is that you say role plays and everybody rolls their eyes and gasps. But I think that this is something that deserves practice, and it's a really good idea for people in groups to think together and talk together about how they're going to talk about the services that you're offering when you talk to your community of your, you know, patients and families about this. This isn't your, you know, this is new and different. It's not a standard psychotherapy referral. The other thing I think about in this, about the services offered, is it's a wonderful opportunity for you to begin thinking about the services you might provide to at-risk populations, people that don't yet have an identified behavioral health issue. There may be prevention services you offer, services for meeting kids and families around developmental milestones, such as starting school, going off to college, working around, you know, targeting kids who have had a recent loss in their family, whether it be through death or divorce. Patients that are encountering a new medical diagnosis, or even meeting patients that are in families that are navigating a chronic or complex medical condition. So I don't know if anybody wants to volunteer, but when you think about an external message, does anybody wanna just take a stab at how you might say something to your patients and families that would describe your program? You can unmute yourself, you can chat, or you can pass. I'll take that as a pass for now. You can chime in later. So next, we're looking at another part of language, which is how do you introduce your behavioral health provider? When you want to include your behavioral health provider in your patient's care, what are you going to call her or him? There are many ways to introduce this colleague. You can introduce them by discipline and or by their role. So if you're thinking about by discipline, it might be clinical social worker, mental health counselor, psychologist, family therapist. And if you're thinking about by role, you have options that include behavioral health consultant, specialist, behavioral health clinician. You can see the list. Or you could be more descriptive, my colleague who specializes in and has a lot of experience with. One of the really important things is that, again, you're not referring, you're including. So the spirit has to be around my colleague and team member. One example you could say is, I have a new colleague. Her name is Jessica Barton, and she's a clinical social worker. Jessica has experience working with children, teen, and parents. Or another option might be, we have a new team member, Maria Araujo. She's a family therapist and is our new behavioral health consultant. Maria can be very helpful in talking to you and your son about your son's recent sleep issues. However you go about this, it's just critical to involve your behavioral health provider in this discussion about how to introduce her or him and describe and talk about how you frame their role. So then the next part is, how are you going to frame the initial visit? Keep it flexible. Don't make any promises. You don't want to set up expectations or be misleading. So one example of what not, I don't like to start with what not to do, but please excuse me for a moment. You don't want to say, oh, I want you to meet Jessica Barton. She is going to fix your child's sleep issues. For example, you know, what we don't know what the determination is. As with any, you know, you all have so much experience with consultations, and you know that a consultation is a focused assessment that leads to a suggested course of action or treatment, but you don't know what the suggested course of treatment or action is going to be until you've had the consultation. So with that in mind, you know, be very careful about what you say is going to happen. Some consultations may be very brief. It may be 15 or 20 minutes, and others may be more in keeping with a thorough diagnostic assessment. A diagnostic assessment takes time, may require more than one visit. and it will entail some combination of meeting with parents, the patient, and the patient and parents together, all depending on the age of the child and the specific situation. But again, we have to just keep in mind that recommendations aren't known until after the consultation. So you really want your language to be very flexible, open-ended, and collaborative. And by collaborative, treatment decisions are made in collaboration with the family, the patient, and the medical provider. So again, no promises on what the recommendations are going to be. I also want to highlight that a single consultation can really go a long way. We have many times, our jargon sometimes is one and done, which means that sometimes you're really able to meet with a family or a patient for a brief consultation and really offer some sort of advice, education, and send people off in a way that's very helpful and productive for everybody. Marie is going to go over some scripts about what you can say to patients and families. So I'm going to pass this off to Maria, and she is going to take over.
Thank you, Ellen, for the warm handoff. I'm going to share my screen, see if I can manage to do it. Okay, I think you're good, right?
You did it. Perfect.
Wow, that's good. Mm-hmm. Hi, everyone. Ellen was just mentioning.
Could you just put it on the slideshow? If you click the button in the bottom right near where it says 60%.
Oh, I knew I was going to have some issues.
Just to the left of 60%, that last, it's like a presentation board.
Is this?
Oh. Yep. The one you were just on.
This one?
Yep.
Yeah?
Okay.
Are we good?
Okay, try to do slideshow up at the top. We can see the slides, it's just not full screen. Yep. I think it's because she has to save as. Sorry, Maria, try saving as. Yep.
Oops.
Okay. We'll just share our screen, Maria, and I'll move the slides for you.
Okay. That's fine. We were talking about how there are different ways to introduce your behavioral health colleague or clinician. And one of the ways we chose to dig a little bit deeper on is the warm handoff. If you choose to introduce your behavioral health provider through a warm handoff, you will do so at the time of the visit. The reason behind the warm handoff is both to establish the initial face-to-face contact between the patient and the behavioral health clinician, and also to confirm the trust and rapport the patient has developed with you to the behavioral health clinician. Many clinicians report that this face-to-face introduction helps ensure that the appointment with behavioral health, if it's a scheduled appointment, that appointment will be kept. So in that way, it's a nice vehicle to enhance engagement. And as I said, also to transfer the trust. Another component of the warm handoff is the importance on reducing stigma, because for many patients, just the idea to be referred or recommended a behavioral health creates this sense that something is wrong with them. So we think that the warm handoff reduces that possibility, but also it's very important the way that you do it. So it's not only doing the warm handoff, but how are you going to deliver that message? The last component of warm handoff is how it saves time. It might be that you think it's going to not save time because you need to spend a couple of minutes in that introduction. However, you know, it doesn't involve a referral, so everybody in the practice doesn't have to get involved and schedule an appointment. If that happens, it's going to happen afterwards. You don't need a phone call. You can just do it right away after the appointment if the person agrees to the recommendation. To minimize the possibility of the stigma, the primary care provider is advised to use neutral terms, terms that everyone can relate to, rather than couching the introduction in a strictly mental health terminology. The involvement of the behavioral health clinician, everybody agrees that will be more effective in the presence of the patient, but we also know that you are busy and sometimes it's impossible to get a hold of the behavioral health. Once the behavioral health clinician starts to get busy as well, it's less likely that you can coincide or get that person out of the room, even though we all know that knocking on the door is fine for our integrated behavioral health, but it doesn't necessarily happen all the time. But we want you to keep in mind that it's a very good way to do the introduction, and as much as you can, use the warm handoff. Some of the presenters from the practices were talking about how they are scheduling the sessions in a way that allows for some time in between sessions. They mentioned documentation, phone calls, but I would add to that that is very important to use it also for the possibility of a warm handoff. When doing the warm handoff, the primary care provider would normally recommend the behavioral health in the same way that they would recommend a cardiologist or any other specialist to maximize the follow-through of the patient with this recommendation. We really believe that the patients, like everybody, will pick up on the importance that the provider implies when they mention this recommendation and respond accordingly. So if you have, if you are not comfortable with the recommendation because it's a new thing for you or because you have not developed yet a system of how to do it, that could be felt by the patients, and you know it would not be maybe enhancing the compliance or the follow through. Several people working in this field have been playing with mnemonics or acronyms to help decide how are you going to do this introduction. One possible way to do it is to use the mnemonic SBAR, and we chose this one because in the PPOC, we use this for written communications about situations with patients, so we thought that many people would be familiar with the SBAR acronym. So yeah, I'm going to go over that. It's like S is for situation. It's important when you do a warm handoff that you start communicating what is the situation of the current patient care that is calling for the involvement of a behavioral health, in your opinion, obviously. Background is describing the skills and the experience of this behavioral health clinician that you think makes this person of the team, to involve in the patient care in this particular moment. So that's why, you know, it refers to the background of this person as a solid person with that experience on that particular situation. We don't recommend that you use the general recommendation as if it didn't relate to this particular complaint that the person is having. We think it's more effective if we just tie it to what the person is bringing up to you as a problem. Assessment would be explaining how is it that this assessment and interventions that the behavioral health is going to do, how is that going to reduce the concern or the problem that the patient is bringing to you? So you are relating this to the overall health of the patient as well. In that way is also reinforcing that not only this person is a person of the team, a member of the team, but also that this is a holistic approach. We all think about how we are bridging the mind and body gap, which is, you know, probably an artificial gap anyway. But how do you refer to that when you use your language is important, because in the everyday we have to continuously address that mind and body are one. Response will be referring to one or more positive outcomes from this collaboration. So you don't want to say only, you know, it's very nice to meet this person who is going to work with you about this particular problem and leave it like just because we think it's nice to have this collaboration, right? No, you just want to add to that, well, this is how we think is going to have an effect on you and your life. So maybe, as Ellen was mentioning, the role playing of this type of mnemonics or how to approach a situation is helpful to you to get more familiar with it. And I would also say that this is something that is for the whole practice, maybe, because sometimes it's not only the provider who is making a recommendation, but the medical home care coordinator or somebody else in the team might be reinforcing this message and getting familiar on how to be specific and use the language of the patient is super important for everybody. Nobody likes to hear terms that refer to maybe illness or some inadequacies in the person. So pay attention to the language that the patient is using. And if the patient is using annoying headaches, that's what you want to build on to maximize the follow through with your recommendation and the motivation of the patient. We have an example, it's just one of many. We kind of imagine that Johnny was a teenager complaining about annoying headaches when he feels stressed out, and that would be the words that we would build on for the mnemonic. So you could say, Johnny, so you're saying that you're having annoying headaches when you feel stressed out and you really don't like taking medication. That would be your situation. Your background would be, I'd like you to work with my colleague, Julie. She has a lot of experience in helping people with annoying headaches and stress. Your assessment part would be, I'm hoping that by working with Julie, you will find ways to make some of the stress go away. And your response to close the loop would be, helping you with the stress will help us manage the headaches without adding medication. So you're not only using the language that the patient is using with you, but you are also building on the motivation of this patient who doesn't want to take medication. So that's something that the person would hear, that, oh, this is going to help me with something that I really want to avoid. So this, as I said, is just one of many ways to introduce your behavioral health. And again, we understand we are very busy, so we are not just saying that this is it, that you might be introducing the concept or making the recommendation when you are not able to engage the behavioral health in the moment. So the basic idea that we try to communicate with this is, however you decide to introduce this person, using the language and complaint of the patient. Motivation and readiness, we all discuss this and we all face this every day. As much as we want the patients to seek help and as much as we think they need the help, they are the ones who decide. And sometimes this can be frustrating because we are really worried, we want them to follow through, we have many reasons for that, and in some cases they will agree and in some cases they will not. Another scenario is that they will agree and then they will not follow through. All we can do, other than trying to use these ideas of the patient language and not building on their motivation, is keep encouraging them and follow up. Just because somebody declined a recommendation one day, it doesn't mean that the next time wouldn't be more open. So we don't have to just give up. It's also a modeling for them. If we don't give up, maybe they don't give up. if you make the recommendation and they decline, a good way to signal the positive, not the negative, would be thank them for listening and validate the trust in the relationship and the honest communication with you, because it takes a lot of trust to be able to say to you right there, no, thank you, I don't want to do this now. So build on that and respect their autonomy and bring it up again in the future. To get the patients familiarized with the behavioral health component of your program, you can place brochures, postcards, signs in the waiting room and exam room, so everybody starts to get the idea and see it like in a more familiar way. We have also more to say about the language. Jonas started mentioning how important the language is for our integrated world, and Ellen just built on that as well. I think of this as something that is not only for the providers, it's for the whole practice. I think if we build a culture in the practice of respect for the language, everybody's going to be using words that are not judgmental. It's a positive language culture. This is a very nice way to call this. I really like that it's called people's language or person's language, because it tends not to conceptualize people on diagnosis, such as an autistic person or a depressed patient, but more a person with a diagnosis of depression or autism. Some examples of how the whole practice can utilize a language that is positive is to change some of the words that we all have used and reflect a little bit on them and maybe change them. Refused, for instance, we could instead say decline, or just the person chose to wait. For non-compliant, that we use a lot, we maybe can change it for had a hard time getting here. For show up late, maybe made an effort not to miss an appointment. And in regard to practicing integrated care and who benefits from this, I think it's important to remember that the whole team can benefit from the integrated behavioral health addition to the team. Burnout is associated with lower patient satisfaction, reduced health outcomes, and it may increase cost. It's important to think of how to improve the work life of healthcare providers, but that includes all staff. Having an integrated behavioral health provider, we believe, benefits the patients and the families, but also the whole team. One thing you can do is go beyond the patient care and maybe think of involving your behavioral health in developing wellness initiatives for the practice and benefit the whole team. Finally, a critical factor in successful integration involves regularly scheduled meetings to discuss clinical and operational issues. So think of including your behavioral health provider in ongoing provider meetings and add behavioral health to the standing agenda, maybe 10 minutes to begin with. It ultimately saves time to have a place to bring questions and concerns about the patients and also the workflows. Many of the presenters in the practices today were referring to these workflows. I think it's very important to be able to revise them and tweak them as you go. And well, we all think this is a work in progress, continuous change, continued discussions will allow you to adapt and make changes as you work together to build your program. And we just want to say that we are here to help you every step of the way. Some of you have been in this journey for a while and we've heard from you today, and we really appreciate your insight and your hard work, and also how good a colleague you are, because you have been sharing with other practices all your wisdom, and you're very, very generous. So that's, I think, very good. I think it's a good moment maybe if you, whether you have started or you are about to start this journey, to reflect on how would you plan for a collaborative and consistent process. And if you like now, maybe you want to share your thoughts about that or ask more questions about it, or maybe this is the time to initiate a dialogue with the participants.
Does anybody have any questions that you want to ask or chat in? While we're waiting to hear from people, I just want to fill out a couple of points we've been talking about. One is that when you're talking about the conversation about teeing somebody up for their first visit, if it's not a warm handoff and it's more of a consultation / evaluation assessment, I think the language I often like to use is something like, you know, would you be interested in meeting with my colleague, Maria Rojo, you know, describe her somewhat and her expertise. And then I would often say, you know, in a meeting with Maria, you'll have an opportunity to talk more about the concerns you addressed today. And the most important point is saying, and at the end, you will work together to discuss next steps. And I think that's the part about staying open and flexible and not prescribing what's going to happen, but being able to say, you know, that's what you'll learn at the end, and you'll be, and embodying the spirit of, you'll be part of that decision-making process. Pause again for any questions or comments. So I'm going to go back to the developing your internal, your consistent vision with your team, because I really do think that's so important. And I know that some of you, it would be near impossible to have your whole practice meet at the same time, because if you're open from 8 a.m. till 9 p.m, it is very likely you have two different shifts of people that are coming in. But I do want to go back to as many people as you can get on board. To collect a group is really critical. And some of the themes that have come up in these meetings that I just think is good for you to know about and prepare for is that the practice manager spoke about billing, and I think that that's a theme we often hear about. Everybody's work is going to change, and it will be more work initially, but it levels out and it's much less than people anticipate. So I think billing was an area that would come up a lot where people thought this was going to be so much, as well as scheduling. And so I think part of it is there are very few procedure codes with behavioral health, quite dissimilar to the medical world. And it's important for people to know that there's really a small number of procedure codes. So from that end of billing, it's not onerous. I think the other thing that's important to know about is that the number of visits and the number of bills submitted a week for your behavioral health provider is very small in comparison to the medical providers. So when people worry about scheduling and billing, they're oftentimes thinking about a scale that's very different than the actual scale of the behavioral health provider. So I think you want to keep that in mind. You've heard today the average number of visits that a behavioral health provider does a day. I think that's going to be helpful in reassuring your staff that the work is not going to be so substantially different. I also think the ongoing role of the care coordinator is something that's come up and is very important, that it isn't that the care coordinator will push downstream all of the behavioral health care coordination work that she or he has been doing, but more that it will be a collaborative process and people will be working together, which is more fun and is time effective and inefficient. Another thing some people worry about is we're going to become a mental health clinic. And the only thing I can say to that is you're not going to see different patients in your practice than you see now. These are your same patients. This is your same panel. It's not all of a sudden going to look like you're walking into a mental health clinic. And then the concern has often come up, and I'm going to go back to the office space, which is many of you will come to us and say, we don't think we can have somebody as a behavioral health provider in our office because we don't have an office we can designate solely for behavioral health. There are plenty of practices where behavioral health providers are working in exam rooms where they don't have their own office, where they're between exam rooms depending on which day of the week. As long as you've got a rolling cart that you can put supplies in, it's all good. As long as you can get a computer, you know, where you need to work, it's fine. You know, ideally, does somebody want, you know, their own office? There could be many reasons why having your own office is good, but I could argue, as most of my team could, all the reasons why not having your own special office set aside in a quiet area, you know, is preferable, because you really want your behavioral health provider, if possible, to be in the hubbub. You want them to be easily accessible so you can knock on the door. You remember they're there. You can tell when they're available. You don't have to walk to another corridor to find them. Again, it's all fine whichever way you do it, but I don't want people to think you have to have a designated separate office. Plenty of people are working in exam rooms. The other thing that comes up a lot, and this is more on the provider end, is the notion that all of my priority patients are going to be seen soon. You know, I'm not going to have any more worries about behavioral health patients. What I can say to that is that this program will vastly improve the access to behavioral health care and everybody's experience, but it cannot fix a broken system. It cannot fix the broken system of mental health care, behavioral health care out in the world and in our state. And our state's better than most, but still, you know, it can't fix that. So you have to be realistic about what your program is going to provide. And in keeping with that, I think it's important to remember that as providers, you still will be involved with your patient's behavioral health issues. You're not pushing the behavioral health concerns laterally or downstream or whatever we might want to call it to somebody else, but you're involving somebody else in your team who's going to probably be playing the key role, but your engagement as a provider is going to make this integrated. And I think that, again, these meetings are so helpful to have, and I really encourage you as you're starting out to find ways to open up conversations, because the more preparation you do and the more of these kinds of conversations you have on the front end, the smoother things are going to be as they roll out. That said, you will want to continue to have meetings and have opportunities for people to talk about how things are going and to work together to create the program that you most want to have in your practice.
Thank you. And thank you to all of our presenters. We really appreciate your time. If there are any questions, feel free to chat them now or unmute yourself. Just looking ahead, this is the upcoming BH101 meetings. Our next is next month, April 23rd. We will be sending out a copy of the slides, so you'll have those on your personal computers. If there aren't any questions, and I think we're just gonna wrap up a couple minutes early. Okay, all right, thank you everyone. We appreciate your time. Have a great day.